Welcome to the Spy Collection. My name is Anastasios, and in this episode we'll have a look at an artifact from the KGB of the Soviet Union. Some of you might recall our episode on the KMC-60 from the 1980s and 1990s, but even before the introduction of such technologies, the Soviet Union had a much more analog version of that. In the 1960s, the KGB's Second Chief Directorate, basically the counterintelligence arm of the organization, was researching for a portable device for copying documents under what they called the operative mobile cameras. The KGB laboratory used a prior design that they had developed called Vunok as their base. In order to modernize it and develop the spy device, we'll see here. Codenamed Zaslon or C-313 when using its model number. Zaslon translates to English in screen as in an object that separates two areas or protective barrier, depending on the context that's being used. And in 2021, a C-313 Zaslon was sold in an auction in the US. It was previously part of the KGB Espionage Museum based in New York, which closed in 2020. It was then sold for $448. It was the device with serial number 90297, which indicates that it was manufactured in 1990. The KGB Espionage Museum's description of this artifact was a Soviet KGB Zaslon C-313 copying device for reproducing classified documents, includes original instruction manual, lens cover, and carry pouch. Zaslon was shipped to operatives in those boxes, and this one's serial number was 90097. Inside, we can find the pouch. We can find the pouch of the device. And Zaslon with its lens cover. As you can see, it was a small and portable device. But of course, this comes with limitations too. The operational objective that KGB designed Zaslon for was covert and fast photography of small documents such as passports, identification cards, notes, etc. This is why KGB started using it extensively not only in covert operations, but also in their border protection units, special operations forces, and later on, even by the MVD, the Ministry of Internal Affairs law enforcement agencies. A key part to its success in the Soviet Union was also its ease of use and no need for an external light source. Basically, here is the film counter with its adjustment screw. And this lever allows the operator to advance the film to the next exposure. On the side, we have the shutter release button, and here is the battery cover. This is the lens or frame cover, and on the upper part we have the film cartridge locked with this lock over here that we have seen also in other KGB spy cameras. Lastly, this and this lever allows us to expand the frame. The film was placed in typical 21mm spools, very similar to most cameras of the time. And assuming we have a film in place, here is what happens when we press the shutter release button. According to the KGB spy camera's book, its lens is 28mm A4M3A type with f4 and a 42 degree angle of view. Here is the full specs of that device based on the KGB spy camera's book. Assuming we have film loaded in the spools, here is how a KGB operator would use this camera. They'd first remove the camera cover, then expand the flap, and place a slon over the document to be copied. Advance the film, take a shot, and repeat this process as many times as needed. And here is how it looks from the inside if we remove the film cartridge cover. Here you can also clearly see the four lights that the batteries are powering, the spring-based mechanism to expand the flap, the battery slots, and of course the lens. Notice that this part is white so that it can have better reflection of the light, while the rest is black, as well as that the lights have reflectors to cover any light from going directly to the lens and the film. Also, on the outside, we see this red dot. This is actually transparent, as you can see here. And is this indicator that the operators were using to know that they took each shot, since it was lighting red anytime you were pressing the shutter release button. That entire cycle only takes a few seconds to be completed. And as you saw from the inside, the device has the optimal distance of the lens and the object to have crystal clear photos, and four lights placed peripherally to have uniform lighting. Actually, that design with a built-in internal lighting was a major innovation that was later replicated by Western intelligence agencies too. It was allowing KGB operatives to take copies of sensitive documents even in complete darkness. And with this design, the light wasn't escaping outside of Zaslon's body, making it even stealthier, ideal for clandestine operations. The only thing that could be externally visible when taking a shot would be the red indicator we just described. Zaslon was operational until mid-1990s, when it was replaced by a newer model that we'll present in a future episode. Clandestinely copying documents is a spying capability that is required even to this day. Of course, technological improvements have changed how this is done, but it's important to remember the history of it, learn from it, and use this knowledge to progress in the future. Zaslon is a great example of Cold War espionage innovation that is not widely known even to this day, although it clearly demonstrates how nothing is as it seems.